CEO of the SETI Institute. And before we get into today's talk, which features a wonderful guest, Dr. Gary Blackwood from Jet Propulsion Labs down in beautiful Pasadena, California, I would like to have just a couple of minutes of your time for some announcements. The first of which actually is, as a reminder, we are closing down the series here at Microsoft. And I'm hoping that by next week's colloquium, I can stand here and tell you where we will be continuing the series from. So that's continuing to work. So this is the penultimate talk. Next week will be the last one at this facility. We had a talk scheduled for April 4th. We're rescheduling that for later so that we can nail down the venue. So if you see that on our website, hopefully we've already updated the website to reflect the fact that that talk will be postponed. But the next week will be the last talk here at Microsoft. So two quick announcements. One thing I wanted to share with you is NASA and the SETI Institute are partnering again this year for an incredible summer workshop we call the Frontier Development Lab. Last year was the first time we did a workshop like this. This year we're launching what is cleverly named FDL 2.0. Basically this is a workshop for PhD students or nearly minted PhDs in two fields or two disciplines. Machine learning on one side, and on the other side, planetary science. In the case of this summer, we're actually going to be including as well heliophysics and also space resources. But the Frontier Development Lab is a 10-week workshop hosted at the SETI Institute. Participants are housed at NASA Ames. They work with mentors from the Institute as well as from other research organizations, including NASA. And we put six teams together. Last year, we had three teams working in the area of planetary defense. This year, we're doubling the program, 24 participants in six teams. So these are teams of four where we pair up machine learning expertise with the relevant science expertise to look at six specific research questions. And the three topic areas this year are space weather, which is basically the behavior of the sun, and trying to do predictive modeling around things like coronal mass ejections and solar flares, et cetera, which can be disruptive and or life-threatening, to say the least. Planetary defense will continue our work that we did last year with respect to asteroids. Last year, we talked about deflection strategies. We talked about using vision systems and drones to find meteorites on impact sites. And we also talked about shape modeling using radar data and basically inferring shape characteristics of asteroids using machine learning techniques and radar data. Very successful program. Space resources is about leveraging mineral resources or water resources that might be on places like the moon or on asteroids for use locally or for use in supporting missions that might be moving on from those locales. So we're now at a point where we're promoting the event. We're looking for, we're reaching out to the academic communities to look for PhD candidate participants and also to the machine learning as well as the science disciplines for mentor and coaching. So if you'd like to know more about the program, there's a website, frontierdevelopmentlab.org, you can get information about the program. There's also a link to that on our site. NASA has a link to the FDL program on their site as well. But we encourage you to take a look, and if there's something you think you would like to get involved in, or if you know people who you think would be interested, please act accordingly, and we'd like to see another wonderful and successful program this year. It was a big success last year. The other thing about it I will point out is that this is a demonstration of NASA's really growing interest in demonstrating public-private partnership. So last year we had NVIDIA and Autodesk partnered with us. This year we're adding IBM. We expect Google to be joining us this year. We expect the Navy Postgraduate School to be joining us this year. University of Southern California's Machine Learning Center and the Viterbi School of Engineering is joining us this year. So it's going to be a really wonderful program. So reach out to me if you have questions, check the websites, and so on. And if I could have the next and last slide. The other is a little more fun, a little less serious, but very important to us at the Institute. So we're having a what we're calling the Space Ball, which is a big fundraising gala event that we're hosting at the Hilton in San Jose. And it's taking place on April 22nd, which happens to be Earth Day. It also happens to be the so-called March for Science Day. We're hoping to participate in, on that in the context of celebrating science rather than protesting the ignorance around things like science. But in any event, it's a very meaningful day on a lot of different levels. That same weekend, there's an event in San Jose at the Convention Center, where the Hilton is also located, called Silicon Valley Comic-Con. And this event is likely to draw about 100,000 people. We will be having an exhibit at that event that was donated to us by the hosts of Silicon Valley Comic-Con very kindly. NASA also has a booth, so there'll be a lot of interesting, engaging, and fun things going on there. At our own gala that evening, that Saturday evening, we will be having a live auction. There's some fun things, including a lunch opportunity with LeVar Burton from Star Trek, a one-of-a-kind magnum of red wine from Bonnie Doon Wineries with the Drake equation on the label and signed by Frank Drake and Randall Graham of Bonnie Doon. So a lot of fun things in that area. We'll have a 30-foot inflatable planetarium. There's not many fundraisers you can go to that have an inflatable planetarium as part of the show, but ours will. And we're going to be giving lightning talks, so some of our scientists will be there talking about their work in little talks. Music and food and drink, of course, will be there as well. So please sign up and buy tickets. Doing so helps the SETI Institute continue its work, not the least of which is putting on programs like the SETI Talks series. So if you can't make it, then just donate. But if you can join us, it'll be a lot of fun. So with that, let me turn the mic over to Dr. Jill Tarter, whom all of you know. If you don't know her, you shouldn't be here. And she will introduce today's speaker.
Thank you, Bill. Thank you. We're really fortunate today to have Gary Blackwood coming up from JPL to talk with us. And Gary tells me that as a young boy, it was watching the Cosmos series that really inspired his interest in searching for life. He got both his MS, his BS, his MS, and his PhD from MIT in aeronautical and astronautical engineering. And then he has been down at JPL since 1988. And he's worked on a lot of technology development for precision astronomical instruments and astrophysics missions, including the Hubble Wide Field Planetary Camera-2, StarLight Formation Flying Interferometer, the SIM Space Interferometry Mission, and the TPF Terrestrial Planet Finder. And since 2012, he's been the program manager for the NASA Exoplanet Exploration Program that's managed out of JPL. It's managed for the Astrophysics Division at NASA headquarters. And so I'm really looking forward to what Gary has to tell us about searching for life beyond Earth.
Thank you, Jill. What a privilege it is to speak to you here today at the SETI Science Symposium. My talk for you today will be titled, You Had Me at Habitable, NASA's Search for Habitable Worlds and for Life Beyond the Solar System. So in the talk, I'll cover a few topics, give you a little bit of a sense of the program overview, the program that JPL manages for NASA and exoplanet exploration. I'll give you some science updates, some of the recent discoveries. I'll talk about how we discover and characterize exoplanets. We'll talk about the progress we're making towards the decadal survey priorities. These are NASA's instructions to us that they give us, the community's instructions they give to NASA every 10 years. How are we doing from the 2010 decadal? And then look ahead towards the progress in science and technology towards the next decadal survey in 2020. And then we'll finish with some habitability. All right, first, to a program overview. So we are NASA's Exoplanet Exploration Program. This program is NASA's search for habitable planets and for life beyond the solar system. We have three things that we're chartered to do in the NASA science plan: find the exoplanets, characterize them, and look for candidates that could harbor life. We serve the science community and NASA by implementing NASA's Space Science Vision for exoplanets. There's our website at the bottom. A lot of really good stuff there. Check it out if you have some time. So I Yelped SETI before I came, and I found this on Yelp. And look how close the mission statement of SETI is to the one that NASA chooses for itself for exoplanet exploration. to explore, understand, and explain the origin, nature, and prevalence of life in the universe. Jill, I think we have a lot in common by our mission statements. Maybe there's more we can do to pull in that direction. If you go to the SETI website, which I'm sure many of you have, they add one more item to their mission statement, which is to apply that knowledge gained back here on Earth to guide present and future generations. So go out and bring back. That theme is recurring, and you'll see that in some of the slides I'll show you later as well. All right, so a couple program slides. This is the scope of the Exoplanet Exploration Program, which I have the privilege of managing for JPL for NASA. We have space missions in the upper left, including Kepler-K2, the WFIRST mission, which I will describe. We do studies for future missions. Some of you have heard about starshades as a way to find exoplanets and look for signs of life. We study those missions and coronagraphs. This is the next generation of exoplanet missions. I'll put these in context for you. We do some ground-based work with Penn State and the University of Arizona and the Keck Observatory. We do a lot of technology development. We invest in the future. Technology enables exploration, and we are the vehicle for that at NASA. We include the NASA Exoplanet Science Institute at Caltech. A lot of the images and the data that I'll be showing you is drawn from a consistent database, three-dimensional database, of our local galaxy. And, well, we have an interesting and active communications group. Who have seen these travel posters before, these exoplanet travel posters? Well, that's something we created, and I'll tell you a little bit more about that when we get closer. This being a NASA talk, I've got one or two org charts. I just need to show these. So we are a program within NASA's Science Mission Directorate, Astrophysics Division. So those of you who know NASA, this program reports into Paul Hertz and Andrea Rizzaghi in the Astrophysics Division. We're one of a set of themed programs. The others are Cosmic Origins, Physics of the Cosmos, managed by Goddard Space Flight Center, and the Explorers Program, also at Goddard. You can find your favorite missions on this list. Under Cosmic Origins, you can find Hubble and Spitzer. Under Physics of the Cosmos, you can find Chandra. And under Explorer, you can find TESS. And this is the final org chart. And at JPL, we manage this program for NASA. We've attracted a lot of great talent to this program. It's a very exciting area. People are drawn to it. And we have the privilege of working on these different missions, not just at JPL, but across the country, working with Caltech. We work with the Goddard Space Flight Center. We work with the Ames Research Center on Kepler. We work with the University of Arizona, with Penn State. In this collaboration for the search for habitable worlds and life in the outside the solar system. All right, so enough on the program. Let's talk a little bit about some science updates. So first of all, it's not even been a month since we saw seven planets above the fold. What an exciting, amazing discovery, this TRAPPIST system. It really ignited the public's imagination so wonderful to find seven planets, roughly the size of Earth, orbiting a cool M star, transiting, only 39 light years away from Earth. What a wonderful discovery, really, really terrific. Let's look at how this fits. These are planets that all fit well inside the orbit of Mercury. They're orbiting a cool M star. There it is in comparison to our solar system, and you can see how tightly packed this system is. Very strange. We weren't expecting to find seven. Even the scientists said, wow, we weren't quite expecting this. This was a discovery by Belgian astronomers and then augmented by the Spitzer scientists using the Spitzer Space Telescope for a 20-day observation. And three of these are interpreted as being in the habitable zone, So I think we all understand what the habitable zone is. It's the Goldilocks zone, not too hot like Venus, not too cold like Mars, just right for life, where liquid water could possibly exist on the surface. Anybody who's been camping knows what the habitable zone is. Here's a group of hardy campers. They have found the habitable zone, and they didn't use Koparapu. They didn't use any equations, and we just lost that. Okay, let me just pop that back in. Okay, that's an odd one there. Okay. So even my file has disappeared from the... Let's try it again. So I had it set up. I knew this might happen, so I set it up so it would pop up. Let's try that again. Oh, there it is. Okay, let me just find the right slide, and we'll go right back to the campfire. That must have been a hot campfire. Now, the campfire for TRAPPIST-1 is much dimmer than the campfire for our sun, and that's why the habitable zone can be much closer in. Smaller campfire, bring that circle in. That's where the habitable planets are. And the reason for this is that this star is much smaller than our sun. There's our sun in the lower right. You can see its radius and our terrestrial planets nearby. There's TRAPPIST-1. It's about the size of Jupiter, just slightly larger, and yet its planets are similar to those of our terrestrial planets in our solar system. What an interesting and unusual system. What a wonderful surprise to discover these planets. This is the Spitzer discovery. This is how they were discovered. We see all these great images on the New York Times. Those are artist concepts. This is what the scientists actually observed. They were watching a time series in a photometer on a detector on the Spitzer Space Telescope, and they saw dips in the light curve, slight dimming in the star. This is the method that Kepler used to find the exoplanets so successfully all these years. And so they saw all these dips, and these dips correspond to the different planets that are transiting. The Belgian astronomers thought they'd found two, maybe three. That third one turned out to be another several. So they were able to come up with this set of seven planets as a result of all of these dips. Occasionally you'll see like a little spike. I talked to the Spitzer scientist, Sean Carey. They're actually residual solar flares. So this is not exactly beachfront property here on this M-star. We think these planets are in resonance with each other, and that these planets are likely tidally locked, meaning one side is really hot and the other side is much cooler. So where would you want to hang out for habitability? Right along the terminator. Along the terminators. It might be just the right temperature there. So you'll see here in the artist concepts, the artist actually tried to indicate this when they were drawn. So if you look at the planet D, which is sort of looks like the most interesting one, it's kind of roasted on one side and sort of uncooked on the other, a little bit like a marshmallow, just a little too close to that campfire, indicating that E, maybe that's a better place, maybe a little bit more temperate, and F is starting to look a little chilly on the right-hand side, being further away. So this is the artist's attempt to draw some imaginary images from the data that was obtained from this system. So E, F, and G are nominally reported to be in the habitable zone of this star. So let's take a trip using eyes on exoplanets. This is something you can look at on our website. It's a three-dimensional visualization that's tied into the NEXI exoplanet database. And so we're going to go first to our sun, and the bright stars are those that have exoplanets. This is three-dimensionally correct with stars in our local galaxy. And we're going to use the tool to go visit TRAPPIST-1, 39 light years away. So we didn't have to travel very far. And so here's the simulation of TRAPPIST-1. Again, all correctly timed in with when we believe the different transits are occurring. And let's go have a look at D. Here's this interesting one here. The artist imagines, oh, there it is, kind of cooked on one side and potentially water or ice on the other. And then looking at this system, imagining where is this habitable zone, it shows it to you so you can see E, F, and G in that habitable zone band sitting around the TRAPPIST campfire. So this is the eyes on exoplanets. This was featured in the news release, and you can use this to visualize any of the exoplanets that have been discovered so far. Yes, sir. How old do they estimate the star system to be? I think it's not as old as our sun. So it's younger than our sun. It's a middle-aged M-dwarf, they call it. Fortuitously, and by design, the Kepler K2 mission observed TRAPPIST for 80 days, and they finished observing at the beginning of March. So there's the Kepler field in the lower left. Back in May, when they were determining where to point this telescope for this particular 80-day period, they tweaked it to include TRAPPIST because they knew something might be happening here based on the early results from the Belgian astronomers. And so Kepler points in different tiles in the ecliptic for 80 days, and they chose this field, and they expect good photometry on TRAPPIST-1 given the transit depths. What the scientists will be looking for is, can they pin down the period of that outer planet H, because they only saw one transit of H, and is there anything else lurking in that solar system? Does it stop at 7, or is there something else out there? The scientists were able to determine not only the size of the planets, but also their mass. From the Spitzer data, because of the way the planets tug on one another. They transit with slight variations in their timing because they're tugging on each other. And that tugging reveals their mass, and that mass was determined for each of the planets. And so here they are. And so these are the takeaways from the TRAPPIST system. The richest set of Earth-sized exoplanets ever found. Again, the scientists said, wow. Including three in the habitable zone, shows that M-dwarf stars, the most common type of star in our galaxy, can host rich planetary systems. And we can expect more discoveries like this in the future. Systems like this will be great targets for follow-up for the James Webb Space Telescope. Planets that transit roughly the size of Earth around cool M-dwarfs. Those are very easy. Those are the easiest targets for James Webb to do spectroscopy on, transit spectroscopy on. It'll be a hard job, but for the ones that are exoplanets that we know about, these are the ones that James Webb will be targeting. And finally, for us to really get for the general case though, we're going to need direct imaging to look at the atmospheres of these planets. James Webb's only going to be able to look at a few of these, because transiting stars are not the norm. Transiting planets are not the norm. All right, let's look at some other results, some other science results. These are Kepler's verified planets by size. So there on the y-axis are the number of planets. This is a histogram. And on the x-axis, you can see the different sizes of planets. Across the top, you can see our solar system. Here are the rocky planets, Mercury, Venus, Earth. Here's the ice giants and the gas giants. And if you look at this, one thing pops out. Look where most of the planets are. They're in a size bin for which we have no analog in our solar system. The most common type of planet that Kepler is finding in the galaxy, we have no analog in our solar system. Somewhere between Earth and Neptune, you go from being rocky, great real estate, to Neptune, maybe not so much. So the universe and the galaxy is revealing itself to be abundant and unusual. When you look at what we call the occurrence rates, when you account for, well, let's see, the smaller ones that are harder to find, and accounting for all the statistics of the observation, removing your observation bias, scientists will determine what they call occurrence rates. How common are the different sizes in the galaxy? The large planets turn out to be relatively few. The most common are the Earth, Super Earth, and Mini Neptune. Super Earth maybe being up to roughly twice the size of Earth. So look at that ratio, it's 15-20%. Wow. In fact, these results are about a year old. There's a group in our community called SAG-13, led by Russ Belikoff. He's in the audience right now. Give us a wave, Russ. I just saw him walk in. Russ, his preliminary results is that frequency may be more than 20%. It may be as high as 60% for Earth-sized planets in the habitable zones of sun-like stars. Wow, 60% of the stars that are sun-like having Earth-like planets in the habitable zone. Gonna have to update the Drake equation. All right, how exciting. So this is all yet to be proven out, but this is the trend, this is the direction the science seems to be going. The galaxy appears to be abundant. And so these are the key takeaways from Kepler. On average, there's at least one planet for every star in the sky. Wow. So when you look up at the sky, imagine every one of those, on average, has at least one planet. And you can see, what, on a dark night, you have to leave San Jose or Pasadena, but you can see 6,000 or so, and there's 100 billion in our galaxy, at least. Second is that small planets are the most common, and that Earth-sized in the habitable zone are also common. What a wonderful result that we're learning from Kepler. This is just coming into our knowledge and our understanding over the last couple of years. All right, well, let's look at the total number for a little while. So we're going to call this Mamajek's Law. Eric Mamajek predicted a few years ago that the exoplanet doubling time for the number of exoplanets was doubling every 27 months. And this is his plot over time of the total number of exoplanets that are confirmed. Jesse Christensen has nicknamed this Mamajek Law. He is now, was from the University of Rochester. He is now the Deputy Program Chief Scientist. Where are the rocky planets? So we love all planets, great and small. Got your icy, your gassy, your, we're particularly interested in the rocky because we're on a rocky planet, so we're curious naturally. Where are the rocky planets? So this is another plot that scientists will make. On the y-axis, different axes now, that's the radius. Bigger planets up above, smaller planets below. And on the x-axis is the mass. Little planets on the left, big planets on the right. So there's Earth and Venus. They're two located there. And so you'll see, Earth and Neptune. Look at Neptune. Neptune's out there. It's about 10 Earth masses. And it's less dense. It's less dense. It's got a much larger radius for its mass. Earth is along a line of constant density somewhere between rock and iron. So astronomers plot this. For the few planets where we can manage both the radius and the mass, we can get the density and we can locate them on this plot. So for all the thousands that we've measured, there's only a couple hundred on this plot. A trend emerges. A trend emerges. Somewhere between Earth and Neptune, remember this is where we're finding most of the planets, there's a transition. Somewhere at around 1.6 times the radius of Earth, or 10 Earth masses, you go from being small and rocky to big and gassy. Something happens in planet formation, and scientists will spend a long time arguing over what this is, where in the formation, you grow to a certain point, and either you stop or you keep growing, and you accumulate a lot of gas in the solar system. So when we debate what is an Earth-sized planet that might harbor life, we tend to be looking at planets up to about 1.6 times the radius of Earth. By the time you get to 2 Earth radii, everything seems to be very gassy above that. Somewhere between 1.6 and 2, there's a transition. So this super Earth, this mini Neptune area, is an interesting area we want to keep exploring. Okay, so where are the TRAPPIST planets? This is the results of the paper. So let's locate them on there. Oh, look, right there, right over by the Earth. They're all rocky. What a wonderful discovery, the TRAPPIST system. Another great discovery last August, a discovery of the nearest exoplanet around Proxima B. People ask, well, where's the nearest exoplanet? You can't get any closer unless you begin to imagine exoplanets that don't need a star, and some people do, by the way, called rogue planets. But this is the nearest one orbiting a star. It's orbiting the nearest star. And again, this is another planet in the habitable zone around a small M dwarf. This is Proxima Centauri compared to the size of our sun on the left. It's part of a triple star system. Alpha Centauri A and B are very similar to the size of Earth. And this planet orbits Proxima Centauri B in close, again, well inside the orbit of Mercury in a habitable zone around that star. Again, prone to flares, so you want to get towards the night side at least if there's a flare. All right, and then a final science slide. Typically, we search for planets around sun-like stars. They're easy to find around M stars, smaller M stars. But scientists will actually find them around the larger stars from time to time. And here's a way. A planet was found around an A star. Generally, you can't find them because of all the stellar activity. But this planet was identified by the phase modulation of the stellar pulsations. So I would say this just goes to show that the planets are common and that Given a chance, scientists will figure out a way to find them, even if they can't find them today. Okay. Oh, and here's an actual movie of a planetary system that's about 140 light years away. This was first detected in 2009, and just last month, a couple months ago, they started making this movie. They've been taking this image. These are self-luminous planets. They're large, warm, glowing under the heat of the formation, not prime real estate. These are planets that are sort of well outside the orbit of Jupiter. And yet, this is a vivid illustration of planets orbiting a star not that far from Earth. All right, how do we discover and characterize exoplanets? Let's take a quick look at that. Many of you actually do this work, so I'll do as quickly as I can and introduce it to the others. So the first thing you'd like to do is just get rid of the starlight and expose the planet next to it. That would be the easiest thing to do. It's really hard. It's like finding a firefly next to a searchlight. But the firefly and searchlight are on the East Coast, and you're looking from the West Coast. In fact, it's about 1,000 times harder than that. So we can find ways to do that. I mentioned the coronagraph and the star shade on the first slide. I'll show you how we do that on some later slides. Another way that we would do this is using the astrometric method. This is a way of looking at the planet tugging on the star. And as the planet tugs on the star, you can't see the planet, but the planet, the star moves relative to other fixed stars, revealing the planet that is orbiting. That's the astrometric method. Here's another way. We like to call this the wobble method. Same basic concept, but now the planet is tugging on the star, and the star is moving towards you and away. Towards you, it's the Doppler shift. The light is shifted blue, and away, the light is shifted red. This has been the workhorse of the early discoveries of exoplanets, this Doppler-wobble method. We'll talk about that again in a bit. Oh, here's what's really been generating all the exoplanets. This is the transit method. Statistically, some fraction of the solar systems will line up edge-on. Less than 1%, but some of them will. And the planets, if they're there, will transit the star. And that they will cause the light from the star to dim by a small fraction of 1%, parts per million, or hundreds of parts per million. And if you build a sensitive enough photometer, you can see this, but you have to stare for a long time. And that's what the Kepler spacecraft did. And that's why it was so successful. You stare at a lot of stars, though. So you need a wide field of view. Another method is called microlensing. This is pretty cool. It uses relativity. And what you do is you stare at a background star that's very far away, and then something passes between you and the background star and causes the light to bend, and it amplifies the brightness of the background star. If you watch that brightness over time, you'll see a significant brightness. You can infer that something passed between you and another star. If that object passing between you and the other star is itself a star that you can't see, but it has a planet orbiting it, this little light curve will have a little blip on it, revealing the presence of an exoplanet. Wonderful little technique, and it's being used right now. Here's exoplanets as a function of time. In 1989, a 12 Jupiter mass planet was found, but wasn't considered an exoplanet at that time. In 95, 51 Peg, that's the generally recognized first Jupiter-sized planet around a Sun-like star. And then radial velocity, the wobble method, was used to find many. Then the transiting planets started to be discovered. And over time, microlensing, direct imaging, they actually found planets by microlensing. And then in 2009, Kepler was launched. Look at the green bar. That's the transit method. And the transit method has produced this enormous bounty of planets. Just staring at a patch of sky that would hide behind your hand in the summer sky in the constellation of Cygnus. That's where it looked. And here's the total statistics. It's very hard to keep that plot up to date. So we just put this plot in, and it's already probably out of date, but it's only a little bit over a month old. So got a little problem here. Must be those solar flares. So a tremendous number of exoplanets. but we want to learn more about them. And what are things we're interested in learning? We're interested in learning not just their radius and their mass and their orbit. Interesting. We really want to get at what's in the atmosphere, or maybe what's on the surface, which might be somehow revealed by the atmosphere. There's different techniques, but if we want to get to the atmosphere, we're looking at direct imaging. And we need to do a special type of direct imaging if we're to look for those that are not just self-luminous and glowing under the heat of their own molten formation. So let's talk about a little progress towards where NASA set us off 6 years ago, and then we'll look forward. So being from NASA, we are an organization of documents. The documents guide us. It's the Decadal Survey. New Worlds, New Horizons was the document in 2010. And NASA flows us down through science plans and implementation plans. And I work towards Paul Hertz's instructions in this plan. And so what are the items that are called out in these plans? The items that are called out include W-FIRST as the next large mission to follow James Webb. But we must finish Kepler. So Kepler is in its closeout. So Kepler is now in its final data processing. This is the last year of the Kepler, the traditional Kepler mission. It's delivered almost all of its products. And this spring, it will make its final update for those occurrence rates and new planets that may be revealed as they've finished tuning their algorithms to search for rocky planets in the habitable zone of sun-like stars. And of course, after Kepler is complete, we will have the discoveries, and we also need their documents. It's always the documentation that takes so long, right? And the final occurrence rate products are on track. But Kepler continues to work right now under the model named K2. Now, a few years ago, Kepler lost two of its four reaction wheels. Reaction wheels are what engineers use to point spacecraft on orbit, and generally need three. So anybody that's taken a physics class knows, you can't point the spacecraft not so fast. The Ames and Ball engineers figured out a way to use solar pressure off the roof line. Look, Kepler has a roof line on its solar panel to stabilize that axis. Wow, to make up for the missing pointing. Well, that's never going to work, right? No, they made it work. The trick is they could no longer point to a patch in Cygnus in the summer sky. They needed to point in the ecliptic for patches 80 days at a time. That's what's indicated on the screen. No problem. There's exoplanets there, too. And so they've been making many discoveries, including observing TRAPPIST-1. They'll be turning Kepler around for what we call Campaign 16 a little bit later this year. It'll point in the forward-facing direction. They'll be looking for mini supernova in a neighboring in galaxies as part of its supernova science, which is beyond just exoplanets. And they've also been performing microlensing, and those results will be released soon. So some of you can look forward to that. In the program is the Wide Field Infrared Survey Telescope. This is a project that is managed by the Goddard Space Flight Center. JPL provides a coronagraph, which is the instrument for the alien worlds. So this is the science is dark energy, infrared survey, and alien worlds. This is a wide field, hundreds of times the field of Hubble. And it's what we call in Project Phase A right now. It's heading for a gate in October of 2017. And we're working with Ball Aerospace and Lockheed Martin on concept studies. One of the topics is making it starshade ready. Those of you who follow starshade, you need starshade to work with a telescope. And NASA is asking, should we make W-FIRST starshade ready? I think we should because of the science that it enables. And I'll talk a little bit about the science that a starshade can enable to complement the science of a coronagraph on W-FIRST. We work with the University of Arizona for the Large Binocular Telescope Interferometer. So one of the things we have to worry about when we're looking for planets is dust. These other systems have dust in them. What does that look like? Well, this is called zodiacal dust because it's in the zodiacal plane. On the left is an image, one of the best I could find on the internet, from the Atacama Desert, showing before sunrise, the zodiacal dust. This is dust cosmic dust in the inner solar system that's reflecting the light of the sun and reaching our eye. The sun hasn't risen yet. This is the dust in our solar system. Well, if we have dust in our solar system, I wonder if we have dust in their solar system. That's the exozodi, and this is a simulation of a planetary system many parsecs away. And if it has dust in that system, it will make it hard to see a dim planet relative to the dust. And so we're looking for systems that are not much dustier than ours, certainly no more than 10 times dustier, otherwise it's going to get in the way of the detection. So how are we doing? Well, they've looked at 15 stars so far. Good news, it's not that dusty for the ones they've looked at. So we do this by looking at a null, and we look at blue calibrator stars and red science stars, and you hope that it's just as sharp for the science star in the red as it is for the blue in the calibrator star. And not like this. If you look at a calibrator star and then you look at a science star, the dust in the other system would blur out the null and reveal the presence of dust. And so for many of the stars they've been looking at, they in fact are finding that they're not dusty, at least at the level of 6, 7, 8 times that of our solar system. It's good news. We're working with the with Penn State on an advanced radial velocity, an advanced wobble method to take us down to the next level of precision. And they're due to commission on Kitt Peak in 2019. This will be used to follow up on the discoveries from the test project and to look ahead for the systems we might look at for WFIRST. And here's an example of the progress they're making. They call this NUID, and it's next to another instrument that they're delivering, HPF. This is what these radial velocity instruments look like. They're basically instruments inside boxes. They need to be very stable. All right, looking, we also manage technology. We have a technology plan where we describe the technology needed to enable these future missions to find rocky planets around sun-like stars and look for signs of life. And we work with the NASA Exoplanet Science Institute. Last summer school is called, Is There a Planet in My Data? And this year will be on microlensing. All right, so forward planning and science and technology to be prepared for the next decadal. So here's the arc of exoplanet missions that NASA conducts. Hubble and Spitzer weren't designed as exoplanet missions, but we see the great results, particularly from Spitzer recently on TRAPPIST-1. Kepler-1 is nearing the end of its lifetime. TESS will launch in 2017, James Webb in 2018, WFIRST around 2025. And we're looking forward towards future missions and designing them now that would actually take us not from finding these planets, but to characterizing them and looking for signs of life in their atmospheres. We call those, you know, the New Worlds Telescope, Habitable Exoplanet Imager, and LUVOIR are candidates. What might K2 and Kepler forward to WFIRST to James Webb for follow-up? Of all the planets that are found, we're looking for Earths and super-Earth candidates orbiting cool dwarfs. Those are the ones that Webb can see, James Webb can see. He'll be using the transit method, not the direct imaging. So there's a few there from Kepler. TESS is going to help us find more planets that James Webb can look at. This is an image from Eyes on Exoplanets showing all the exoplanets. The stars with exoplanets are indicated in bright. Those that are relative to the sun have this geometry. There's quite a few around the sun. That big thrust over in that direction, those are the Kepler targets. It stared at one patch in the sky, so it found a whole bunch in that one column. They tend to be hundreds or thousands of light years away. A little bit too far for the James Webb telescope. And so that's where TESS comes in. So whereas Kepler looked out in one pencil beam, TESS will look around the whole sky, and it will look much closer, about 10 times closer. Brighter stars, more photons, easier to follow up. Look forward to those results. And the WFIRST telescope will use microlensing to finish the survey begun by Kepler. So think of this as a census. Kepler found planets. I think I'm too close to some signal or something. So Tess, Microsoft sells the aliens. So Kepler began a census, but Kepler's census could really only go out to periods roughly that of Earth, because only look for 4 years around sun-like stars. And to finish that census requires that we use WFIRST for microlensing. The microlensing from WFIRST is sensitive to the planets that are further out, beyond what we call the ice line, out where Jupiter and Saturn lurk. And it will fill in those planets in that blue area, and that will fill in the census and help us understand the demographics in our galaxy. And so what will Mamajek's Law look like 10 years from now? Well, those are the projections from TESS and WFIRST. I think we're on track for another 10 years of doubling every 27 months. This is another parameter plot that scientists will draw, looking at the contrast ratio versus the inner working angle. You can sort of see our solar system down here in the lower left. Our solar system moved out 10 parsecs, a little over 30 light years. Earth is down in the lower corner. Jupiter is easier to detect. So where we are today, we're able to detect planets that are way up to the right, far from their star and right. WFIRST will take us a long way, next big step with the chronograph. But what we want to do is get down and find Earths around sun-like stars. And that's our challenge. Now, our challenge to do that is we've got to get rid of the photons from the star. That star is only a point. What you see there is the diffraction. We can't get rid of diffraction, but we can manage it. We can engineer it by blocking out the light. How might we do that? We might block it out by using an internal occulter called a coronagraph. Basically, you put a mask inside the telescope and you steer the light away. Or you can fly an external occulter, a starshade, to block that light out. Let's look at a coronagraph. A coronagraph looks at a star. The light comes into the coronagraph. The light traveled perfectly for hundreds or thousands of years, but got a little distorted as it came into the telescope, and the telescope itself puts in a diffraction pattern. So we put a coronagraph mask in, and we just steer that diffracted light out to the outer annulus, and we put a washer in and block it. And so get rid of that starlight. The planet, since it's slightly off axis, sneaks past all those filters and lands on our detector, but we still can't see it. Why not? Those perturbations on the coronagraph created all kinds of speckles, but we used deformable mirrors to shape and take out the errors in the telescope. And by using an algorithm called wavefront sensing and control, we can slowly but surely reveal exoplanets hiding in this dark hole. That is the basis for the WFIRST coronagraph. This has been demonstrated on the ground, and we'll go to space, and we'll take it to the next level. Let's look at a starshade. Now we're just going to get rid of the light before it enters the telescope. We're going to launch a separate spacecraft. They're going to unfurl from a central hub. That central hub is going to deploy, and it's going to form a starshade with an optical shield. All those petals are shaped in such a way to send the light away from the inner part of the telescope. You fly the telescope in the shadow of the starshade. They're about 35,000 kilometers apart. And all right, there's a little artistic license here, but it will reveal the presence of exoplanets orbiting their star. That's the concept of the starshade. And here's some examples of starshade deployments that we're conducting at JPL, showing the deployment in the lab with all this is one motor that reels in a cable, and mechanical engineers will see that we're turning parallelograms into rectangles, and that's how we deploy the structure automatically. An open wheel won't do, so we need to package an optical shield to block the light. And so this is the origami method. Turns out origami plus a set of summer students can really move the technology along. And so we're scaling this up step by step. And then how do starshades and coronagraphs compare? Scientists study both methods, and it turns out that for relatively small apertures, small 6 meters and below, the starshade is favored because the starshade can see closer into the star. It lets more light through. Those are good things for exoplanets. And you can find a greater yield. As soon as you get out to greater aperture sizes, or you want to find more exoplanets, you want to use a coronagraph, because starshade is not just like pointing a telescope. You have to move the starshade, and the starshade gets limited by fuel. And these are missions that NASA is considering for the New Worlds Telescope, LUVOIR, HABEX, Origin Space Telescope. And so these larger missions will help us in our ultimate quest, which is to look for signs of life on these worlds. And so the signs of life that we're looking for will include looking for habitability, blue of the sky, water, and potentially biosignatures, oxygen, and methane. A lot of debate in the science community about what is a positive indicator versus a false positive, but these features, as we see in the Earth spectrum, would be strong indicators that there's something interesting there for habitability or signs of life. In the interest of time, I think I'll skip over some of these slides and indicate that NASA is continuing to invest. And one of the things that they picked recently, just yesterday in fact, was to study the Starshade mission for further study flying with WFIRST. It's not part of WFIRST yet, but to study a Starshade mission to enable WFIRST to do that exoplanet detection. A starshade with WFIRST will allow us to find exo-Earths in the 20s. Imagine that. Exo-Earths in the 20s. And, all right, I took a picture from my whiteboard. We were sketching, but we would find, we'd be able to survey 30 or 50 systems. And depending how abundant the planets are in the galaxy, how high Rus-Belikov's eta number is, we may find a handful or more of exo-Earths. And for some of those, if they're bright enough, with integration time, look, see signs of habitability, water, or maybe even signs of oxygen, which would be an indicator of biological activity. These are the technologies that we're advancing for coronagraphs and for starshades. So in the interest of time, let me end with you had me at habitable. So there's quite a bit of interest in exoplanets. It's really a great connection with the public. But I think all of us as professionals also feel that. And what's that about? There's just tremendous interest. When we publish the TRAPPIST results, we put out a new exoplanet travel bureau poster, imagining and placing ourselves on that world. And we've really connected strongly with the public on this. And I thought to myself, you know, what is this? Is this curiosity? Is it wonder? And I think it's more than that. And let me address that on three slides. And I'll just start with, quickly, a little bit of my story. So as Jill described, like many of you, I was inspired by Carl Sagan's Cosmos and his poetry in describing the galaxy. I watched it with my dad, who's a World War II vet. He was in the Royal Air Force. And the motto of the Royal Air Force was, per ardua et astra, through struggle to the stars. So my connection with my dad was, he did the struggle, and I do the stars. It's always good to find some connection with your dad, right? But influence for many of us goes back to our teachers. I had a great teacher in first grade. Myrtle Folsom was her name. And she challenged us to imagine, this is back in 1970, that there might be something beyond Pluto called Planet X out there in the infinity waiting to be discovered. That was a big concept for a six-year-old. But here's a picture of me and Myrtle just before her 102nd birthday. Yes, I stayed in touch with her. And imagine her delight in learning that there were exoplanets beyond Pluto. And so I became interested in the field. I pursued a career at NASA, and I wondered, the first time I saw the Milky Way at the Philmont Scout Ranch, I grew up in Jersey, so you didn't see the Milky Way growing up there, but I did in New Mexico, and I wondered, as Carl Sagan did, on these other worlds, are there beings who wonder as we do? And I jumped at the chance to be part of NASA's Exoplanet Exploration Program to search for habitable worlds and life beyond the solar system. They had me at habitable. I claim that the connection for exoplanets goes even deeper than wonder and curiosity. It will be a long time before humans ever travel to an exoplanet. We don't know how. Maybe they will one day. That hasn't stopped the NASA JPL artists from imagining what these worlds are like. These are the different NASA travel posters. And none of us will ever, no one in this room will ever travel to an exoplanet. They're just too far away. Grandparents will not see their grandchildren grow old. It's just not possible. But exoplanets, like children, represent hope. Hope is the word I think that exoplanets bring in. They represent something of the future, something beyond us, something of infinite possibilities, the possibility that we are not alone in the galaxy. Exoplanets, like children, are a promise of the future and something really wonderful for today. And to drive that point home, I'll end with this one slide. This is our team's motto, which is very similar to a SETI motto, by the way, exploring a galaxy of worlds while inspiring our own, bringing it back home. We went to Pasadena Astronomy Day, and we met a family taking a picture in front of our travel posters. This is a family in the LA area that named their child Kepler, after the astronomer, after the mission, after exoplanets, because they love exoplanets. His name is Kepler Cloutier. Look at him in that little jumpsuit. Isn't he adorable? Here is Kepler. It's not showing on here, but he's only about 9 months old here, but he's 33 on Kepler 16b. And on TRAPPIST, he's much older than us. And so here's a picture of young. We invited him to JPL. And here's a picture. Some of you will recognize Steve Howell, the former project scientist of Kepler. And he spent the day with us, played with some of our planetary buddies. And so how do you come up with a caption for this? You know, show me the planets. You had me at habitable. Thank you very much for your time.
Oh, thank you so much for that, and for ending with hope and inspiration. I think that was wonderful. Let me start with the first question, and that's, why do we stop at methane and oxygen and biosignatures? Why aren't we interested in the mathematicians as well as the microbes?
I personally am, but NASA's scope only goes that far. So I think where you're going with this is the reason why many of us are involved in this field personally, but it is not part of NASA's charter. As charter to the Exoplanet Exploration Program.
I think that the charter could use some revision. Okay, anyone who would like to ask a question? We'll start with you.
Thank you. That was a great talk. So speaking of charter and revision, we all know that NASA's budget is tied to the federal budget proposals of any given administration. So I was wondering, given that this is a long-term plan, what shields you have, or sunshades or whatever, to protect you, your budget, and how safe is that timeline under the vagaries of changing administrations?
Well, that's a really hard question to answer. But what I will tell you is that we lay out these five-year plans, and we tie ourselves into the decadal survey. And the Congress looks carefully at what the decadal survey recommends. And the decadal survey pulls from the most compelling science across astrophysics and across, and there's different decadal surveys across the Science Mission Directorate. So I think the best defense is a good offense. And our offense, if you will, is to provide the most compelling science for the decadal survey and Congress and the public to choose from. And I've put my career and my time into what I think is the most compelling science, looking for habitable worlds and for signs of life.
What technique is being brought to bear to improve radial velocity measurements down to half a meter per second?
The question relates to the wobble method and what we're doing to get that sensitivity lower. more stable reference oscillators, more stable systems, more time on the telescope, and the experience that comes from design, build, assemble, test. I can give you a more specific answer. I'd need to look that up. But Penn State has been building a series of these, taking advantage of what's been learned by the Europeans on the HARPS instruments and applying that at the next level down. So this is an incremental build. One of the things that's being looked at to go even beyond the 30 centimeters per second that Penn State is looking at is to get above the Earth's atmosphere. You've got the stellar activity and the tellurics of the Earth's atmosphere. We don't have any plans to go above the Earth's atmosphere for radio velocity now, but that is one of the studies that NASA just commissioned last Monday to look at that possibility. And then you've got to deal with the stellar jitter. Bill.
David, thank you so much for a very extensive, comprehensive talk. Well, one of the things you started out talking about, though, was SETI. Is there any opportunity for SETI and NASA to get together to work on, you know, after all, the first discovery of life might well be by SETI? I know for a while Congress was set rules against that, but I don't know whether that's changed.
Mm-hmm. So Bill asked, what are the possibilities of SETI and NASA working together? So right now, SETI and NASA do work together in small ways. SETI scientists work on SOFIA. SETI scientists work with the Kepler project. But your question goes to something greater. And it's true that NASA and SETI NASA hasn't funded SETI since the early 90s. So there are people who set policy and they set the funding. But I think what we can see here from the material that we have in front of us today, build the discoveries that your mission have provided for us, and look at the common mission statements that we have between the NASA big questions, the NASA Exoplanet Exploration Program, and the SETI mission statement. They're all very collinear, and I think they speak to a common human yearning to show that we are not alone. And I think if there's a possibility of us joining forces in answering that question, we really should explore it. But I don't know of anything actionable in front of us right now except to continue that discussion.
Hi. I'm interested in whether or not there's any work being done to detect auroras on these exoplanets, the importance of them being that they would indicate a magnetic field, and if you've got a magnetic field, that would provide you with some shielding from cosmic radiation, which would in turn protect life forming on the surface of the planet.
So that's a great question. I don't know the answer to that. I've been to a number of science conferences. I'm not a scientist myself, but I do know these questions get asked along with finding exomoons and other features of planetary systems. And so that is probably at the level below our detection threshold now, but it hasn't stopped scientists from beginning to ask that question. And as I alluded to earlier in my talk, if there's a science question that's interesting, eventually scientists find a way to answer that. So I'm not aware of anything active in the missions that we have planned, but I know scientists ask that question. And there may be somebody in the audience who can answer that question.
Yes. Yeah. University College London as a group is basically working on detection of HV. University College London as a group working on detection of HV plus emission, which is a type of aurora that you can detect at 3-4 micron. And there is also a group at Observatoire de Paris who is trying to detect the decametric emission from the magnetosphere of systems with planets.
So there's the possibility if we can imagine a valuable physical natural system that we want to observe or natural process, that process will reveal itself in some way in scientists like the gentleman to your right. We'll eventually find the measurement technique that picks up on how it reveals itself. Yes, sir.
Yes. You presented some experimental data on, you know, which planets are rocky and which ones are gas. Are there any, you know, solid theories, you know, that help us understand what the threshold is, what factors impact that?
Well, yes, there are a number of planetary formation models that are active in the community.
And they are models of the galaxy, which are informed by the data. So there's a back and forth between the data and the models. But there are some models that support the formation of rocky planets under certain processes that are and that support the formation of the larger gaseous planets. And so, yes, there are models that are driving the observations, and there are observations that are driving the models. And so there, again, maybe some experts in the room that can give you more specifics on that.
Okay, Frank, you get the last question.
Hi, very good talk, thank you. You mentioned that ultimately the goal is to image exoplanets, to characterize the atmosphere and see the surface. We had various talks here at SETI Institute on how we could build an instrument to image and characterize exoplanets from the ground. People have been presenting that over the past 3 weeks, for instance, using mid-infrared observations or improving GPI, the Gemini Planet Imager, which is also funded by NASA. Is there any interest from NASA to continue this kind of investigation, to fund this kind of investigation instead of investing in expensive space-based telescopes?
Well, sure. So the question is, can you? What is NASA's interest in ground-based observations for answering these questions? So, so NASA, by its charter, and we talked about charter before, not including SETI currently, our charter for NASA is space. So NASA complements the work on the ground. So NASA won't invest in the ground per se, ground telescopes, but we are aware of it, and the studies that we conduct for these large mission studies will be informed by what the National Science Foundation and other private organizations are accomplishing on the ground. So we're aware of the capabilities of the ground today. We're aware of the capabilities that will be out 10 and 20 years, you know, with some uncertainty. And there are areas of parameter space that the ground will excel at in a working angle and detection, particularly in the near IR. But there'll be some targets based on, you know, our conversations with the ground where we'll want to take it to the next step. So an Earth around a sun-like star is going to be, you know, at or beyond the capability of the ground as we understand it today. So NASA will complement the ground, but will not directly fund those ground-based investigations. But we certainly keep track of that. Thank you.
Okay, Carrie. Like to present you with our SETI mug, and maybe that will remind you of the benefit for looking for the inhabitants as well as the habitability.
Right, let's do that.
And let's thank our speaker.
Thank you very much, Jill. Thank you.
So, Gary, this is the only thing more coveted than the Ryder Cup, the Stanley Cup, and the Davis Cup is the SETI Cup.
Wow.
So, there you go.
All right, thank you very much.
That was a wonderful talk. I just wanted to address Bill's question earlier, which was also brought up a little bit by Frank a few minutes ago, and that's the issue of NASA's funding and the possibility of NASA funds being used for SETI work. So there is no longer any congressional mandate preventing NASA from funding SETI science, SETI research and endeavors. But since that, you know, early 90s, NASA has really steered clear of that particular branch of this search for life beyond Earth. The newest congressional mandate, if you will, for NASA is a little more open in its language. And in fact, Congressman Lamar Smith, who is an interesting character on his own right, but is nevertheless in charge of Science and Space Technology Committee for Congress, and they basically put together NASA's charter for funding, actually extracted some language from the SETI Institute's mission statement and embedded it into the NASA mandate that is now awaiting final signature from Trump in terms of the funding. And that does open up more possibilities for supporting SETI endeavors. There's much more language in the new mandate about searching for life, about searching for life, and not only in terms of astrobiology, but also in terms of the evolution of intelligence, et cetera. So there's at least some optimism that, you know, the winds may be changing somewhat at headquarters, and we may, in the years ahead, start seeing the opportunities for direct NASA funding for SETI activities. So we're ever hopeful. Thank you again, and thanks, Gary, for a wonderful talk.